we are just interested in, for GPS, we are just interested in the latitude, longitude, and also the accuracy of the location, and maybe the user ID. So I can add here, I can select user ID, and location, see that the first data that we received, I believe the time zone here, yeah, but the time zone is the local time zone here. So this, the first data that we received was at 11 a.m. from this location. And this was the location that was recorded, and this is the accuracy. You can run filters here as well. You can say, for example, only show me the ones that have accuracy of any other sort of filtering here. Say, well, just show me the ones from user 3377. User ID. Yeah, we only have 300 records. You can see that 300 records is up until 6 p.m. See, after 6 p.m., we have got nothing. So after 6 p.m., either the app has stopped working or the app was terminated or something. We'll look at that. But it's clear that we have data from until like exactly if we ordered by reverse, the last data we received was 6:23. Anyway, so for every data source, as we talk about it, we'll come back and look at the data that's available here.
Okay.
Closer. Okay. Now back to how the location data works. Location data can come from two data sources, either from GPS, that's available both on Android and iPhone, and the other one comes from Wi-Fi, that's only available on Android. So basically, if you know the proximity to Wi-Fi access points as well, you can extract the location data from there too. But so for now, just if we focus on GPS part, the data from GPS is collected as a periodically, happens 1 minute every 5 minutes. But because GPS is actually very battery consuming, the app uses some methods to reduce the battery consumption. One of the things that it uses is that it doesn't collect data for the entire 1 minute. If it can read three high accuracy readings, it stops. And high accuracy readings is defined as lower than 3 meters of accuracy, like 3 meters or better in accuracy. If it finds three readings with this specification for that 1 minute interval, it stops. Otherwise, it tries for 1 minute to get the data. The other thing is that the app tries to detect if you are stationary, and if you are stationary, it uses the same reading as before. The way that it works is that, for example, you come in the in here in the morning, it captures all the time that you are commuting to here, but as soon as you come here, it realizes that, okay, you are stationary, you're still in the same room. It doesn't capture anything until 6 or 7 p.m. that you start, or I hope you're not here by 7 p.m., but 5 p.m. that you start heading up. Then it starts to collect data again while you are moving. When you become stationary, it again stops collecting data. It also, but 5 minutes every, 1 minute every 5 minutes, especially if you're driving, is not accurate enough. So especially if you are moving or running or biking or anything, you probably need the data to be collected continuously. This can be configured for the data to be connected, to be collected continuously, either always continuously, like regardless whether they are, you are stationary or not, or only continuously while moving. Then the way it works is that it detects when you are stationary or when you're moving, and if you are moving, it continuously collects data. So it's not one. there are not very few people that are always moving around and they're always in crowds. So other people mostly come to an office or place of work and stay stationary and then go home and get stationary. So I believe when we introduced this feature a couple of years ago, that around that decreased the battery consumption of GPS and data storage by nearly 80%. So that really impacts the amount of battery that you use. Now the most battery consuming data source is not GPS anymore, it's actually a raw motion sensor data, and I'll explain why they are in the next slide. And a few considerations about this is that it's battery intensive of work. It can be turned off, and permissions for accessing that can be revoked. We talked about that people might turn off the GPS, people might turn off or revoke the permission for that. And it captures approximately 80,000 records per participant per week. That's roughly the amount of data that you can get from participants. We can start visualizing the data here, but I'm afraid that if you go on visualizing data for every data source, it actually takes a lot of time right now. We will spend most of tomorrow trying to visualizing this data that you can see. But right now, it's just helpful if you just can look at the data here. You can expand each row here and look at every individual data. If I expand this one, you can see that for this particular data point, these are this is the device ID that was sent. I know that this is an iPhone because usually the iPhone device IDs are a bit longer. Android is usually half of this. This is the location that was captured. Provider of it was GPS. It can come from different sources. For example, the location can come from the Wi-Fi triangulation. That's another method that's used for locationing. And record time, the speed was minus one, means the speed was not detected, and the accuracy was 65. So roughly around 65 meters. Around 65 meters around. I believe if you just copy and paste this in Google Maps, we should be able to get you. Oh no, she was right. First has to be. Exactly points to this building that we are at. We'll see how we can plot heat maps and paths that people have taken either in the ETCA dashboard or in Kibon. As I said, can be used for two different purposes. One is that you can use to have a general sense of people's proximity, because if all of your participants are seeing a certain access point, a certain Wi-Fi router, probably that means that means that they are close to that particular, they're close in proximity, they're close to each other. Either they're sitting in different places in the same room that router is, or in the same distance. Especially if the signal strength of the reading is comparable for both or for multiple participants. We can access the Wi-Fi here as well. We can go to management, index patterns, and say, I'll create a new one. And this one's going to be ES780. Field name also is record time, but created. Now if I come back to discover here, I can pick which table I want to look at up here. I can say I want to look at the Wi-Fi data. Okay, it shows by default the issue that I have no Wi-Fi data. I probably have to remove this accuracy requirement, because that's what we're doing here. I'm just going to remove these requirements. Have to use these fields from. We have to remove these SSID. Let me just look at one of them. What is called SSID, which is basically the network name. This is URSTM. That's the network that we have seen. The time that's been captured. Stored as level. The level is -40. As you can see, it also is negative. So the higher the higher the value is, the higher the signal, or the higher, the closer people are to this particular axis. And the difference between SSID and this one is that it's a unique ID of the router that you're close to. But for example, U of STF is the network name that is available across the campus, and there are a lot of routers with the same name. About for contact networks, Bluetooth and Bluetooth beacons. We used beacons yesterday, and we said that Bluetooth beacons more and more is phased out, and it's not very helpful to capture proximity, and we use beacons for that purpose. But we still added the data source to see what the data that we get. As we talked about yesterday, it uses the smartphone's built-in Bluetooth sensor to capture Bluetooth devices, and it's only available in Android. It also collects data periodically, similar to Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi also collects data periodically, 1 minute every 5 minutes. Here also, it works to collect data 1 minute every 5 minutes. You will see that most of the data sources capture data maximum 1 minute for every 5 minutes. Because this way, the app can go to hibernate or sleep mode for the other 4 minutes, and that really helps with the battery. You couldn't continuously collect data. It would really impact the phone's performance of battery. Bluetooth, similar to GPS, can be turned off. Accessing it requires more and more, more and more limited due to privacy concerns. Data volume depends on. And the data volume depends how many Bluetooth devices are around. Because, well, of course, if you scan, you find how many Bluetooth devices are around and you report those, right? So it's usually it's not more than 17 calls per record per participant. So there are somewhere that there are a lot of Bluetooth devices, still the roughly the number of records that you expect. If you look at the data here, create connection to this data as well. There was a spike in the morning in the number of Bluetooth devices seen. Usually at night there are very few because people are at homes or hotels, so there are not many Bluetooth devices around, but then you come to the office to see more Bluetooth devices, and that's why you see a spike here. One thing interesting here is that if you actually click on each of these fields, it shows the most common values that come for that. Like for example, one item here is the device name, the name that you assign to your Bluetooth device, for example, it's your headphone or if it's a car or your phone. If you click here, you can see that most of these have an empty string. Basically, the device didn't provide any name. These are the names the device publicly broadcasts, similar to Wi-Fi's name. So if you scan, you would be able to see a couple of other ones. For RSSI, you can see that the signal strength for most of them are around minus 70. Between minus 70 to minus 80, that's most of the data have the signal strength. But that's only for 500 records, as it's written. While in total, we have got how many? 9,217 records. can also filter all of these as well. See, yes. For everything that has signal in it, the value is written in decibel. That is reversed. That goes from minus. It starts from I think minus one, and goes lower than that. The lower it goes, it means the signal is weaker. That's true for Bluetooth. That's true for, bless you, for Wi-Fi, and that's true for Bluetooth beacons as well. All of them work all of them use the same concept. That's why for Wi-Fi, I think for Bluetooth and Bluetooth beacon, we had RSSI, which stands for Received Signal Strength Indicator, which starts from minus one and it goes to, I think, minus 512 is the lowest that it can go. Most of the values fall some. If you are really, really right next to the device, it's I think it's something between minus 30 to minus 40. If it's below minus 150, it's too weak. It's very easy to test. You just simply have to have a beacon, and just if you install an app, it shows the RSI value, and as you move it further to the phone, you see that the number that scans drops. That scanning drops. We did the Gimata yesterday, right? Installed an app. I can show it later on. The value of minus 75 here means that it's probably like a few meters away. For Wi-Fi, it's slightly different the way that this value is measured, but still the same concept. It's something starting from minus one and it goes down to minus 200, minus 300. So. Most are, yeah.
So if you have
So all of both Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and Bluetooth beacons, their hardware allows adjusting how strongly it has to emit the signal. For Wi-Fi, and of course, it's always plugged to the outlet, so the battery doesn't matter. The power resource doesn't matter as much, so they always use the strongest signal that they can, and it makes the interface simpler as well, so they don't have to bother people with, okay, how strong you want your signal to be. Well, as strong as you can. Distribute in the house or anywhere. For Bluetooth, the same. There's a default value. Usually, it's not something that you can configure. But for Bluetooth beacons, because there are a lot of different use cases for them, it's something that you can configure. You can say that I want this beacon to send the signals very strongly, at the cost of using more battery, or I want it to send the signal very as weak as possible, but I'm just using it for a very small area. That is one thing that impacts the RSSI. The other one is basically if it's an open space, there's no obstacle. So the further you get from that device, the lower the RSSI. If there are obstacles, for example, walls and other things, they can also impact you. So if you go across the wall, as we talked yesterday, the value drops. The other one is the battery power. Usually, if the battery power of the beacon drops a lot, then the RSSI value also is impacted and shows lower values. because it, of course, it impacts the power that it has to send the signal. There are a lot of research that's done to convert this to a distance, how far the person is from the device. There are a lot of work that's done on converting RSI value to the distance. We talked a lot about beacons yesterday. Just a few points to mention is that it also uses Bluetooth. It's actually just like Bluetooth. The only difference is that it uses a new protocol called Bluetooth Low Energy, or BLE. That's why it runs on these small batteries for so long. It's supported both by Android and iPhone. It uses iBeacon technology. There are two standards here. One is called Eddystone, and the other one is by Google. The other one is iBeacon by Apple. Eddystone is only supported in Android, but iBeacon is supported both on Android and iPhone. That's why we use this one. And usually all beacons of all different kinds, they support both of these standards. When you purchase the beacon and you want to program them, it asks you what standard you want this beacon to work. You can choose iBeacon or Eddystone, either of them. In our documentation, we instruct using iBeacon because that works on both Android and iPhone. If you use Eddystone and you have iPhone users, they will not be able to see that beacon. But this is that's why FBA uses iBeacon from Apple, both on Android and iPhone. Designed to capture proximity to external objects and collect periodically every five minutes for 1 minute. So the way that it works is that the app wakes up every 5 minutes, looks around and tries to find any beacon that is around it. For 1 minute, looks for every beacon around and just writes them down and stores that data and uploads them. One thing you need to consider is that if the there are many people with the beacon in the room. Like, for example, there was one use case that there were like a class of 200 students, like an undergraduate class, and they wanted to capture their contact pattern. And if you have a phone with 200 beacons around, there's not enough time for the phone to capture all 200 of them in this 1 minute. Even, it's not only about time, even if you give it like 10 minutes, still it's not able to capture all of these beacons. That's why when you go through the data, especially when there are a lot of beacons around, you see that some beacons are seen in this cycle, but in the next 5 minute cycle, the beacon disappeared. And then the next one, the beacon just appeared again. If you remember, when we were looking at proximity data yesterday, it was a line below it was written that Ethica considers a beacon as departed if it's not seen for two consecutive cycles. So it's not seen right now, it's not seen for the next one either, we mark it as departed. But if it's just for one cycle we can't see the beacon, we assume that can be potentially because of the surrounding is busy and the beacon is not matched. But regardless, the data is collected. For every cycle we report what data is in scene. So it's up to you when you are interpreting the data, that whether you want to interpret one missing cycle as a person being departed, or whether you want to interpret it as, there should be more cycles with data missing, with the person not being present to be marked as part. And there are these two standards, but a lot of manufacturers that are producing them. The ones that we used yesterday, they're from two manufacturers. One was contact.io, the other one was Gimbal. All of them follow the standard. What makes the difference is that their shape, their battery options, whether the battery is replaceable or not, their cost. Usually they cost from $10 to anything more than $100 a piece. So they have a very, depending on the features that they offer and their battery life and everything else, their price is different. So some of them look like a credit card, some of them look like a sticker, like these ones up here, some of them can be worn as a wristband. You can just see what shape fits the best.
Well,
the ones that I used yesterday, they're like around $10 a piece, and they're very easy to program as well. They're different shapes as well, but the ones that right now we have. Yes, Bitcase. Yes, I think the link is in our website as well. I think the documentation that's how we program them. It is, yeah, I can share the link. But I know the link is in our website. Good. Yeah, as I mentioned, it's not guaranteed that a given beacon is detected on every scan period, particularly an issue if there are many beacons in proximity. Okay. I'm not sure what I want to do right here. Sorry. Our site can be used as a proxy to the distance between the phone and the beacon. So yeah, let's create connect to the Bluetooth table. We can connect to beacon table here as well. And see the beacon data that we've connected. Data is collected. If I go to beacon, yeah, you can see that yesterday when we started this, like at first there was like around 1 PM, the data started to be collected. I've seen people make a lot of mistakes picking which sensor exactly they need. It's very clear. There are a couple of sensors that provide you with some indication of how the phone or what kind of activity the person is engaged in. The sensor is available both in Android and iPhone. And there are three types. Well, I have two. I'm talking about the raw hardware. So before I go to it, I have to explain what the raw hardware is. Because there are, I've divided them into three: the raw hardware-based data, the raw software-based data, and the high-level data. I'll go through each of them one by one. Basically, the physical activity or motion sensor, there are three types of sensors that are available in smartphones and wearables, and basically everything else that you purchase that claims that it can detect motion. And the three sensors is the three hardware: accelerometer, gyroscope, and accelerometer. These are small chips on your smartphone and your smartwatches and everything that can detect motion. The reason that you can draw hardware, because as I said, there is a hardware piece in your phone and your wearable that captures this data. And the hardware is actually the same whether you have a Fitbit or whether you have another type of wearable or whether you have a smartphone. It's exactly the same hardware. There's actually very little variation there. So it's not that the accelerometer data, that the accelerometer sensor that Fitbit uses is different or better than the one that Samsung uses, or it's different than the one, for example, your smartphone. All of them use a very similar sensor that has a very similar output. But these are, they call it raw because what they measure is not really usable. What they measure, for example, accelerometer, is the force of acceleration in every direction. But the force of acceleration is that if you hit an object like this, there's a force of gravity as well because it's pulling it down. So it measures that you are pushing it up with the value of 10. Because it has to, so similarly, gyroscope and magnetometer, they are raw sensor data that captures something very specific that hardware allows to capture, that can be translated to the motion. The only, as I something like a smartwatch, it's always at people's wrist. So you know that if you want to interpret it, you should assume that it's on people's wrist. If you actually start wearing your smartwatch in your pocket or in your ankle or anything else, it will have like incorrect data, like it will impact the data accuracy. But the difference with a smartphone is that you don't know how it's held. Like I can hold it in my hand, I can have it in my back pocket, I can have it, I don't know, in my front pocket, in my backpack. The point that I don't know where the phone is located impacts the data accuracy. That's why we talk about pedometer data collected from smartphones is not as accurate as pedometer data collected from wearables. It's not that because the hardware that you use, it's because we don't know how the phone is kept. If we ask people to always hold the phone in their hand, we'll get the same result. But well, we can't guarantee that people hold the phone in their hand. As Nate said, when I work, for example, on a walking desk, I put my hand on the desk, and my hands are stationary. Where my phone is in the pocket. And at the end of the day, when I check, my phone shows like very a close estimate of the number of steps I took, but my smartwatch shows I took 10 steps. I might have walked for 2 hours. So because it's stationary, it just doesn't capture it. But the point that's important is that there are just three sensors that capture motion. Now, anything, any object that captures motion, it uses one of them. As you can see, compared to what we had before, it collects a lot more data. We're talking about like 10,000 or 80,000 and so on. They collect 6.5 to 7 million records per second. That's a lot more. And that's why they impact battery a lot, because the app has to collect this data, store them, keep them, save them, upload them, and do it over and over again. I think it's around 1,200 records per every minute that they collect the data. So that really impacts the battery. Yes. There is actually one team that right now is doing that, like using our system. That there's probably a lot more research that's being done comparing Actigraph, but one interesting thing is that Actigraph also uses the technology is not different. It's just probably their the instructions they have for research is different, and something that they have established this brand as something that's validated. Otherwise, it doesn't mean that, for example, Samsung created. I think one of the companies. Creates a different set of sensors for Actigraph, but sells a different one. That's not the case. Yet. Thank you. one last thing is that if you read these, it's probably, except the accelerometer that you guess probably measures the acceleration. I also don't know. Like, what is the IRC? I know a bit what they do, but I don't know the specifics of what they do. That's why there is, only for this case, there's something called raw software-based data. There are three other sensors. There's no hardware measuring linear acceleration or force subtraction or device orientation. But because these are so much easier to use, there is a certain software written in that module, in very close to that hardware, that can work very fast. And because you're dealing with hundreds and thousands of records per minute, it can get these and convert it to these two. And these are easier to understand. Linear acceleration means basically if I'm holding something like this, the linear acceleration is zero. If I'm moving it in any direction, it shows that back. Otherwise, it doesn't show. It shows the acceleration of this item standing here is zero. The force of gravity basically how the gravity is applied to different parts of this. The orientation shows that how I'm tipping the device. So this, these three sensors basically are identical to these three. So these three hardware data are processed, and then they are software uses some technique called sensor fusion, combines the sensor data. That's why you see the number of records that you expect from these is still pretty high, but it's normalized, roughly 3.5 million for each of them. Unlike this one, that you have a lot fewer magnetometer data, but you get a lot of gyroscope data and accelerometer data. So one thing that's very important to note here is that it's almost always useless to collect all six of them. Unless you really, what you're doing is comparing these ones, basically are measuring the accuracy of the algorithm that does it. So if you are not doing that, collecting these three is just useless. That's what we did yesterday. We add all six of them. But it's no use. You either need these three if you want to start from the raw motion sensor data from coming from our process them, or you can use these if you're just fine working. Now, but that even these ones are hard to do. Like, it doesn't say much. What's the acceleration and so on, right? So there are some software like by Apple and Google that they receive this data and convert them to some high level data, like pedometer, that convert them to number of steps taken, or motion-based accuracy calculation, basically says that based on sensor data, person is probably walking, or person is probably biking or running, and so on. This is the same algorithm that probably like Fitbit has their own, or the other ones, Actigraph have their own, Actigraph has their own, and so on. They get this data from these sensors and convert them to pedometer data. So as or clicks, that when the person walks. And as you know the placement of the sensor on the person's body, the accuracy of converting that sensor data changes is higher. From without knowing how the sensor is located, they have to process the data in a way that converts that to step count or the accuracy. But again, then the same data is available to all apps in an iPhone or in an Android. Because, for example, iOS receives this data, processes them, converts them to pedometer data or step count data, or convert them to motion-based data, and shares it with Apple HealthKit and all the other apps. So if you collect data from Google Fit, or if you collect data from another app as a step count, or if you collect data from step count from Ethica, the values are identical. Because that's where the source is, that's where we get that, and that's where the algorithm applies the logic. All of a sudden, the are calculated. So it's not that once every 5 minutes I see how many steps I take on for that one.
And the reason is that
we don't need to store the data. We just get the data, process them, discard it.
And say, okay, the person walked 10 steps, discard the data. And we only record 10 records,
not 1 million records, 60 million records.
And in total,
you get around. Orders of magnitude.
Similarly for motion, we have to mention that they could just read the same thing, and this one is not done periodically. For technical reasons, this one can continuously capture that. It can generate values like you're on foot, you're walking, you're running, you're biking, you're on a vehicle, you're tilting your device, you're the place on the phone. Usually for every cycle, it tells you what event is detected and what's the confidence of.
90% confident person is walking. Basically, anything lower than 90% confidence is not very helpful. We'll look at this data and then we can go for a break. The only thing I want to say is that if you try to connect to the two tables in Kibana, it doesn't show anything. The reason is that these two tables, because of the size of the data, we have to store them separately. Because the storage that we were using, we're not able to capture, it easily can go over like 100 million or like a billion data records, and the system. We're not able to store it at that scale. So we have to store it in a separate data storage. That's why it's not accessible to Kibana. But you can check it. It depends on the research question. Almost, again, most of the cases no, unless what you're doing is comparing how this answers to this, you don't need to collect all of them. You only need either this if you need the high level data, if you need just the processed data. But if you need raw data and you prefer to try your own algorithm, for example, you're working on an algorithm. And extract pedometer data.
You can collect these records.
There's one team that I know that's using that credit for this purpose, but I know a lot of teams that I don't know what they do, but they add all 8 of them. And these 8 sensors, of course, they take a lot of storage on our end because I'll show at the end that they roughly use 90% of the data storage when you run a study. So they increase the battery consumption by 10 times because that's just how much battery needed to store the data, to keep them and so on. So it's very important to know which of them you need to get at that particular point. Okay, so if I come here and I create an index to ES780, create one for motion-based activity for motion as well here. If you look at the pedometer data for it, it shows that 0 steps were taken for the participant. Let's add the user ID and steps. For most of the lines it's going to be zero. I think I'm again at I can exclude all the zero readings. So in total it's 7,824. If I say steps is not zero. confidence level. Confidence level for Android and iOS is written differently. For Android, it's a percentage from 0 to 100. For iPhone, is one of the three values, either low confidence, medium, or high confidence. So it's that's why you see it's different. These are here too. For Android, this number here 46, 78, these are coming from Android. So you can see that the device size is longer. There's in the documentation again, if we go to motion sensor, here you can see that 0 is unknown, 1 is still. So here what we see is mostly either unknown, we can exclude that as well here, we can say activity time is not one. And that it's not exclude the ones that the reading is. Yeah. So right now we are down to 3,800 records. And we can also say show the ones that have come into the wall for more than of course, this excludes all the iPhone data because iPhone's reading is different. And it only goes to the what was one? One is still. So 99% or 2% confident the person is standing still, read for on foot and walk. You can see that it says the person is walking. You can just figure that modify the data, just modify the query. Okay. Yeah, so we can stop here. I think already we are bit over time. We can have a break and then continue looking at the rest of the data.
It takes only 3 days to learn how to use this.
It captures it. I mean, you can hear it. It's faint.
Okay.
So, yeah.
But I captured from this as well. So.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. For.